We're teaching the book of Ephesians in the morning, and we were at chapter 5, verse number 21, submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God. And as I saw, you know, as Kyle gave a testimony and explained what was going on with Charlotte, his brother's here, and all that kind of stuff, I as he was saying that and the reaction that he got from the congregation and so forth, I thought, you know, this is not an Ephesians 5:21 morning. I called a message this morning. I'll teach it later. I called it the most unpopular verse in Ephesians, submitting yourselves. That's bad words today. Today everybody wants to fight for their rights. Submitting yourselves unto one another in the fear of God. Grace people say, well, we're not supposed to fear God. So that verse starts bad and ends worse. And I planned to teach that this morning, but it really wasn't. So I changed on the spur of the moment to Romans 5. And we went down through the first 10 verses of Romans chapter 5. And I thought I'd finish that chapter tonight. We're doing some things on Sunday night just as an interim study on great chapters of the Bible. And I've repeated Pastor O'Hara's advice for a number of years that every believer ought to have in your mind to be able to recall instantly the first 11 verses of Romans chapter number 5. And that was why I went over them this morning, because they're exactly what's going on with the Grahams. And we watched it go on with the De Velascos. We watched it go on with other folks here with less emotional, maybe, kind of apparently emotional things with children. But I was thinking this morning, as I was looking out across the crowd, there were probably 30 people and family groups this morning that have had, equally terrible things, difficult tragedies, whether it's health things or family things, betrayals, sinful things, and so forth, that you bear burdens and you have trials and difficulties and pressures that come in life. And Romans 5 is the answer for those things. It's the practical impact that justification gives you. And as those verses 3 and 4 and 5 are verses that you just need to have clearly in your understanding, because that's where you live as a believer. And it's where you're designed to live as a believer. It just happened, I taught some of that stuff on the radio Sunday this morning. And I didn't make that program today, of course. I didn't make it anticipating all these things happening. But I just thought I'd finish the chapter, because Romans 5, the latter part of the chapter, doesn't get a lot of attention. We got down through verse number 10. Let's just start in verse 9. Much more then, in other words, there's more involved than just what he just said. Being now justified by his blood, that's what the first 8 verses are about, we shall be saved from wrath through him. Now that's wrath, that's just wrath. You'll never face the angry face of God in this life or the next. That's a wonderful thing to know. That's a comforting thing to know. The justice of God deals with you and I as believers, you and me as believers, in a different way than it did before we got saved. Now we're in Christ. We have God's righteousness. And so God's justice is never out to deal with our offense, because we have none. We have peace with God, and the angry face, the wrath of God, we'll never face again. For if when we were enemies, now here's an explanation, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son. If when you were an enemy, you were reconciled by the death of his Son, made friends by the death of his Son. Much more, being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. One, you're saved from wrath. Now you're saved by his life. And that's the resurrection life of Christ. And that salvation, that's not just justification, that's the justification of life. That's the gift of life. And I try to say to you that salvation, our justification, there's two issues to the cross work. He dies for our sins. He puts away our sin and our sinning. And then he gives us life. There's the resurrection. So there's the finality of the cross in putting away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And there's the reality of life in Christ Jesus. So he says in verse 11, and not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement. The result of all that is that you have joy, unspeakable and full of glory. And we have that joy in God. Don't fear his wrath. We have peace with him. And now we can rejoice in who God's made us through the Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement. Now, I'll just do an aside here about that verse. That verse is one of the popular verses in grace circles to tell you that the King James Bible is wrong. Because that word atonement there is the English translation of the same word that's translated in verse 10, reconciled. And when you see the word reconcile there, reconcile to God, and we've been much more being reconciled, that word reconcile, the Greek word there, katalasso, is translated in verse 11 as atonement. And so people say, well, see, the translators translated it wrong in verse 11. It shouldn't be atonement, it should be reconcile. Well, first of all, understand, they knew how to translate it as reconcile because they did it twice in the previous verse. Okay? So it wasn't a mistake. They did it on purpose. Number two, the word atonement, at one meant, means reconcile. You're put back together. You're at one with somebody that you were separated from. Now, the reason people say it's a mistake is because they have the faulty view that atonement is an Old Testament Mosaic doctrine and that reconciliation is a New Testament Pauline doctrine. And they say, well, when Paul says, by whom we have now received the atonement, they're talking about an Old Testament doctrine. Now, the doctrine, come back to chapter 4, the idea in the Old Testament, the idea that is taught is that in the Old Testament, atonement only meant a temporary covering. Leviticus 17, 11, it says, the blood is given on the altar as an atonement for your soul. That blood on the altar, the blood of the goat there on the altar that's given for the atonement of the soul, that blood didn't permanently take away sin. Hebrews 10 tells you that. It was a temporary covering. The blood of bulls and goats can't take away sin forever. So they said, well, see, the word back there, atonement, the Hebrew word is the word kipher. Now see what I'm doing? In order to make your Bible wrong, you got to be a Hebrew and Greek scholar. You got to get a Greek salad and a Hebrew dressing. We rode by a place yesterday, a falafel sandwich place. And Bill from up in Wisconsin, he and Brenda, we were taking him around. He said, what is a falafel sandwich? A what?
Falafel.
Falafel.
Well, no, you pronounce it wrong, so I don't
get it. How did I say it?
It's really pronounced falafel.
Falafel. Okay. You know what I'm talking about, though, right?
Yeah, it's a chickpea
mashed up. Right, it's a Middle Eastern.
Yeah, they're falafel.
Right. Yeah, I've had them. They're good. I like them. And he was, I was telling you that for some reason. I can't remember now. Anyway. There you go. It's a Middle Eastern dressing. The Hebrew word for atonement back there is a word that is translated, kipher, is used back in Genesis when Noah put pitch on the ark. And it's a word for covering. He covered the ark with pitch. And so they say, well, see, the word in the Old Testament is just a covering, but it's a temporary covering, not a permanent covering. And so when you read about atonement in the Bible, in Moses, it's a temporary covering. Well, Paul didn't talk about a temporary covering in Romans 5, so it's a mistranslation. The problem with that is that's a totally bogus view of both the Hebrew word and the Greek word and the English words. The word reconciliation is used repeatedly in the Old Testament to talk about the atonement. So the atonement, at-one-ment, and reconciliation is an Old Testament doctrine, but it's not one that is foreign to the word atonement and the word reconcile are used interchangeably through your Bible. The idea of the atonement in the Old Testament being a temporary covering is kind of a strange one. Look at Romans chapter 4, verse number 6. Romans 4, 6. Even as David also described the blessedness of the man unto whom God imputeth righteousness without works, saying, Now, he's going to quote Psalm 92. Okay? Blessed are they whose iniquities are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Now, in the Old Testament, that's a quote from Psalm 32, where the Old Testament covering is talked about. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord will not impute sin. Now, does either one of those verses sound temporary? No, they're not temporary. That's a permanent. What is the covering? It's iniquities being forgiven. It's not imputing sin. And there's nothing temporary about that. When Paul used the term in Romans 4 that he quoted out of Psalm 32, he wasn't talking about some, well, that's a doctrine back there and is all temporary, and now we have something permanent. He's saying forgiveness, covering, atonement is what we have here. Now, the reason he says atonement in chapter 5, verse 11, isn't that and by the way, we've been through this before. You go back in the book of Genesis and take that word covering. When Noah pitched the ark, covered the ark with pitch, was that a temporary covering? Have you ever gotten pitch? It's like creosote. Have you ever tried to use creosote pitch? It won't come off of your hands, folks. That's why you have to use gloves. I've gotten it on my hands, and your skin has to wear off to get rid of it. It's not temporary. It's a pretty permanent seal. And when he pitched that ark, that wasn't some temporary, only going to last some time. That was a permanent, watertight seal. It's successful. And if you use that term in the Old Testament, you follow it, you find the second time it's used, the ark's the first one, you'll find it doesn't have anything to do with the temporary covering. Now, the point being that when people tell you those things, what they're doing, and they use the Greek salad and the Hebrew dressing and the falafel, and make a falafel out of it, they're just doing what they do. You can leave your Bible like it is, and when it says, by whom we've now received the atonement, we've now received what David was talking about in Psalm 32. We have our sins are forgiven, our sins are covered, atoned for, and God will not impute sin to you. That's the permanence of your salvation. That's the permanence of your forgiveness. We have now received that. Now, you see in that verse when it says, by whom we have now received the atonement? That's the issue, is the now. When does Israel receive her atonement? That's what she gets at the second advent, the Day of Atonement, Acts 3:13. Repent and be converted that your sins may be blotted out. Atoned for, covered over, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. Israel has to wait till then. We've got it now. That's a difference. That's a dispensational difference. Now, that word atonement, you see when he's put that M-E-N-T on the end? Atone, at one. But when you make that noun out of it, you put that M-E-N-T, that ment suffix on it, that suffix is a suffix that has the concept of a result. And it's the idea, you add the idea to the verb, or the at one, you add the idea of permanence. If you say something is settled, then you have a settlement. It's a permanent settling. It's over. It's done. And you settle it, the verb, the ment, it's permanent. And it's the concept of being the result lasting. And you go through your dictionary and you think of any word with a ment on the end of it, and you'll find that it carries that idea of permanence. Now, that's why he gets into what he does in the rest of the chapter, because the rest of the chapter is going to be kind of, it's like I said, most people go through the 11 verses of Romans 5 and they quit the rest of it because it's kind of confusing if you don't follow along with the issue of the permanence. Verse number 12. Wherefore, by one man, because of the permanence of your atonement, there's something you need to understand about it. Wherefore, by one man, sin entered into the world, and death by sin. So that death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. when it says, as by one man sin entered into the world. Sin, when he says that, is not a verb, it's a noun. He's not talking about the action, he's talking about the source of the action. Whereby, as by one man, and by the way, what he's going to do in Romans 5, he's going to start out and you're going to talk about one man. And that one man is going to be Adam. Then you're going to talk about, in a minute, you're going to talk about another one man. And that one man is going to be the Lord Jesus Christ. And what chapter 5 is going to do is contrast between what Adam did and its results and what the Lord Jesus Christ did and its results. And all of the action and all of the result come from just those two men. That's critical to understand about your justification. Wherefore, by one man, sin entered into the world, and death by sin. So you're going to get sin, you're going to get death. Where? From that guy right there. For that all have sinned. There's the verb. There's the actions. Why do you take the actions? Because of the nature of sin. The noun is where the problem is. The verb is the fruit of the tree. For, until the law, now by the way, you notice verse 13 starts with a parenthesis. Look down to verse 17, at the end of verse 17, there's the end of the parenthesis. That means verse 13 through 17 is a parenthetical statement. You take a parenthesis and put it into a sentence. You can take it out of the sentence and the sentence is still whole. But you put the parenthesis in the sentence to explain something that you're saying. So really verse 13 through 17 is an explanation about this one man that brings death. So it says in verse 13, for until the law, sin, the noun, was in the world, but sin was not imputed where there is no law. In other words, there's no personal guilt. Sort of like that verse in 2 Corinthians 5 when it says he's not imputing their trespasses unto them. Nevertheless, even though there's no personal guilt, death reigned from Adam to Moses. So, what's reigning? Death. Adam to Moses. What happens with Moses? Then the law comes in. But before the law, the issue, and what Paul's doing here is he's making the point, the issue really for you and me isn't Moses, it's Adam. Moses isn't the problem. Moses just pointed out the sins. The real problem is where did the sins come from? Moses pointed out the fruit. That's an apple tree. That's an orange tree. That's a fig tree. Where'd the figs come from? The nature of the tree. Where'd the nature of the tree come from? Adam. So getting rid of Moses doesn't really solve the problem. Except Moses just said, fig tree, fig tree, fig tree. But what's going to change the fig tree? Death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them who had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who was a figure of him that was to come. So here they aren't personally doing what Adam did, and yet death reigns. So the problem isn't the sins, the problem is its source. But not as the offense, so also is the free gift. Now that's a great way of saying something that you say, what? And I think your Bible sometimes has phrases like that. Somebody said, well, you know, the King James Bible is confusing to understand. Dude, go read the Greek text. It's confusing to understand too. Okay? So don't get too fired up about that. When he says, not as the offense, in other words, it's not like this, so also is the free gift. It's not like that. It's like this. So he's going to make a contrast. He's going to compare Adam, and he's going to compare the Lord Jesus Christ. He's going to make a contrast between what Adam did and what the Lord Jesus Christ has accomplished. And there's going to be a series of contrasts of opposite comparisons. It's that. That's not this. This is not that. He's going to make these opposite comparisons to make a point about the greatness of God's grace. He starts in verse 15. For if through the offense of one many be dead, much more the grace of God and the gift of grace, which is by one man, Jesus Christ, hath abounded unto many. So you've got one man, Adam, and you've got one man, Jesus Christ, and what Adam does over here, Jesus Christ is going to, when he says abound, when you abound, you go beyond. What the Lord Jesus Christ, the first contrast is that Adam's going to do something and Christ is going to outdo him. The gift of grace, what Jesus Christ accomplished, goes beyond any of the things that Adam, sin, produced. That's why at the end of the verse, chapter 2, said that where sin abounded, grace did what? Much more abound. And not as it was by one that sinned, so is the gift. For the judgment was by one to condemnation. So what Adam's going to do with the sin and over here is he's going to bring condemnation. But the free gift, what Christ is going to bring, is of many offenses unto justification. Now justification is the idea of having righteousness, being made righteous. So the result of what Adam does brings condemnation. The result of the gift of God's grace, and that's what he calls this thing over here, so the gift of grace is going to be righteousness. Our righteousness being, his righteousness being imputed to us. For if, verse 17, if by one man, man's offense, death reigned by one. So what's going to happen? The condemnation results in death, and death is going to reign. Death reigned by one. Much more, they that receive abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign in what? Life. So the death is replaced by life. And that's going to be eternal life, life that lasts forever. You'll see that in just a second. Now, verse 18. Therefore, now, if you go back to verse 12, and let's read it skipping the parenthesis. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. Verse 18. Therefore, as by the offense of one, judgment came upon all men to condemnation. Even so, by the righteousness of one, the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. So you have verse 13 to 17 kind of explain the one man issue, but you have Adam sins, introduces sin, brings condemnation, brings death. What Christ does is he brings grace that brings righteousness that takes care of the condemnation, and then he brings eternal life that answers to death. One man does it, one man on one side, one on the other. Verse 19, for as by one man, it's disobedience, many are made sinners. So by the obedience of one, many be made righteous. It's two men that are the issue. The issue is not your performance, your failure, it's theirs. Moreover, the law entered. With the law, here came the law. Here comes Moses. that the offense might abound, that you might be able to see it everywhere. But where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. When the law came and pointed this out to everybody and made sin go berserk, you know, abound every, grace says, hey, I'm still ahead of that. Now, verse 21, and here's the punchline. Grace abounded much more that as sin hath reigned unto death. Now, that means that when sin reigned, it produced, when you reign, you become a slave. You're ruled by sin. What the grace of God is going to provide is you're going to be free. And you're going to have the free grace of God and the life that God gives us. That's what he's talking about back in verse number 17. When he says, much more they which have received the abundance of grace and the gift by grace should reign in life. In Christ you're free from the reign of sin. Now verse 21, that as sin hath reigned unto death, even so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, when he says that grace reigns through righteousness, righteousness means to have a right standing with God. When he says that as sin hath reigned unto death, how did it reign unto death? By one man, by his disobedience. Even so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ. One man's obedience, one man's performance produced righteousness. That's not your righteousness. When it says grace, that grace reigned through righteousness, that's not your righteousness. Look over at chapter 10, Romans chapter 10. It's the righteousness of faith, not works. There are two types of righteousness in the Bible. There's your own righteousness, your self-righteousness, and then there's the righteousness of God, which is by faith, the righteousness of faith. And the only way to have God's life control, the flow of life in you, to reign in you, is to understand that the righteousness of faith is the issue here. Chapter 10, verse number, talking about Israel, verse number 2. For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believes. So the righteousness back here isn't what you do, isn't what you perform. It's what he's performed. And that's Paul's point here. When you're worried about, have I done enough, or did I not do enough, or am I bad enough, or am I... Listen, you're bad enough because you're in Adam. Your lostness comes from just the fact that you have an identity in a fallen creation. Your salvation comes the same way. Your justification comes the same way. It's never what you did, it's always what he did. And so the righteousness of faith, the justification of life, the free gift, it's the righteousness of Jesus Christ that you get by trusting him that brings eternal life. Verse number 17, for if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness, so you have to receive it, trust it, believe in it, depend on it. And when you receive that abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness, justification, you reign in life by Jesus Christ. That's written into verse 18. He calls it the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. Verse 21, grace reigned through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ. It's his life, his righteousness. And you see, when you're out, you see people, when you see religion, By the way, there's a hokey things happen at church sometime. After church this morning, after morning service, I don't know if you saw me stand up here talking to this young guy, this young guy from Jamaica and his wife. They'd come with some folks, and he told me, he said, do you believe in miracles? I said, yeah, the Bible's full of miracles. He said, no, I mean, do you believe God works miracles today? And I said, well, what do you mean? I don't know what you're talking about. I mean, look, if you get saved, regeneration is a miracle, okay? So, you know, I don't just generally say I don't believe in a miracle. I knew what he's talking about. I wanted to make him explain it so I was clear. And he said, well, I've seen many miracles. And what get to what he wanted to do was, he told me what he wanted. He said, I have healed people with my hands of cancer. And if you can let me have that little girl talk to her mom and dad, that little girl, I think I could heal her. Well, you know, that wasn't going to happen. So anyway, we had a conversation about some of that. And he asked me, do you believe God still talks today? I said, yeah, he talks through his word. Well, he didn't like that. So finally I asked him, I said, tell me, how and when did you come to know for sure you have eternal life, all your sins are forgiven, and you're a child of God with home in heaven? Well, and then he started, you know, and it was, you know, it's all this works and experience. I said, I'd ask about your experiences. When I asked that question, I didn't mean give me a travelogue. I said, what did you believe that makes God, if God says you face God, then he says, why should I let you into my heaven? What are you going to tell him? And his answer was, well, I've asked him to forgive me of my sins. Well, but why would he do that? I mean, I look at you and see that you don't deserve his favor. And he's lost, probably. And I asked him, I said, if you don't know for sure how you have eternal life, and you don't know for sure God's going to let you into his heaven, what makes you think that's God talking to you about how he's going to fix your paperwork and give you a dream to get into America out of Jamaica? Why wouldn't God say, get saved? Trust my son. Oh, by the way, he already has said that. He said, well, that's why he didn't have to say it again. He already said it. I said, he didn't believe it to start with. So his whole thing was what I do, what I do, what I do, what I do, what I do. Paul's whole thing here is it's not what you do, what you do, what you do. It's what Christ did. Because the problem, look, everything you do can't undo who you are. Because before the law was there, when nobody was pointing to what you do, you still were dead. Okay? The law's not the problem. Adam's the problem. Jesus Christ, what he did is the answer. His grace is the answer. And that's why the law isn't the issue. It's grace abounds and it reigns through the righteousness of Christ. Now, sin reigns under death. Sin reigns by the law. The law gives sin, it's the strength of sin. It keeps pointing out your sin, keeps pointing out what you did. The young boy asked me, he said, what do you do when you sin? Shouldn't you ask God to forgive you? I said, a believer when he sins should stop. Christ already forgave him. When you got saved, Jesus Christ, look, your sins were 2,000 years into the future when Jesus Christ died for them. So when you received the forgiveness of sins that you got the moment you trusted Christ, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. When you trusted Christ as your Savior, the payment that he made for your sins was applied to you and your account. You're in him. Now you have forgiveness. By the way, there is no forgiveness outside of Christ. Okay, all the stuff about lost people having their sins already forgiven and all that kind of stuff, it just comes from people can't read the Bible or don't read the Bible or, well, they just don't read the Bible. Nobody is forgiven at the cross. Not a verse in the Bible says you're forgiven at the cross. The verses say you're forgiven by the cross. It's how you're forgiven, not when. You're forgiven by the cross. Acts 3:19 says Israel's sins will be blotted out, forgiven, when Christ comes back. Their sins aren't forgiven at the cross. They're forgiven at the Day of Atonement. Romans chapter 11, Paul says, this is my covenant, quoting Isaiah, this is my covenant with them when I shall take away their sin. When is God going to take away Israel's sin? He never says he's taken away at the cross. He says he's taken away at the advent. How? By the cross. Don't get how and when confused. And that's the fundamental issue. It's unto all and upon all them that believe. It's for everybody, but it's only applied to people when they believe. So all this stuff you hear runs around the last 2-3 years, has run around the grace circles, mainly on Facebook, on the internet kind of stuff. But and people pick it up and teach it other places. But it's been around for years. And part of that's because, like that thing I said a minute ago about atonement, that's really a Plymouth Brethren doctrine that gets brought into the grace movement because grace people have some of that background. This stuff comes out of universalism, the forgiveness stuff. It's a part of the universalist idea. But a lot of grace people, and especially Acts 28 people, have been around or in the universalism. So you begin to hear doctrines like that, and people aren't equipped to think it through. Listen, when you receive forgiveness is when you trust Christ. I'm sorry. And that's because that's when it is applied to your account. That's the when. The how is the cross. But you got to understand the distinction between how and when. Ephesians 2:16, he says that we're reconciled unto God in one body by the cross, not at the cross. And that's important. Anyway, that's a falafel. That's a, what is it, a rabbit trail. Verse 21, but that as sin hath reigned unto death, even so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ. The permanence of your atonement, your reconciliation to God, is based on the fact that Jesus Christ is the one that provides it. It's not you, it's Him. And you've been, just like you had an identity in Adam, now you have a new identity in Jesus Christ. The identity in Adam gave you condemnation, death, slavery to sin. Your new identity in Christ abounds in giving you righteousness, complete total acceptance as a gift, life, eternal life. You completely defeat death, destroy it, and then freedom in Christ, for His grace to reign in your life. In verse 17, when he says, the gift of righteousness, for by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign by one, Jesus Christ. You see, the person reigning in that verse is the believer. You're going to reign over sin. You're going to reign over the satanic program and policy of evil. You're going to reign over the world system. You're going to reign over whatever the calamities in life come along the way. God's faithful to give you the capacity to be patient and endure through that. You're not going to reign over any land, political system, until the kingdom comes. But what we're reigning over now is we're reigning over all that Adam did to us, because we are in Christ. And when he says, you're going to reign in life, there's the old thing about Christ is on the throne and you're down here. And he said, Lord, he literally invites you to come sit on the throne with him and do this thing together, do life together with him. Because he's going to treat you like an adult. And he's going to give you the privilege of decision making and based on a renewed mind, educated by the sound doctrine of God's word. And that's why when you start in verse chapter 6, and it says, what shall we say then? in light of the fact that we have all of this in Christ Jesus because of what he did, not what we did. What do we say then? Shall we continue in sin? Again, that's the noun, not the verb, that grace may abound. God forbid, how shall we be that are dead to sin live any longer therein? How shall we that are dead to that stuff over here, how should we go live like that's still who we are? And then he starts explaining that in chapter 6. So when you get to chapter 6, the issue of identification in Christ and all he's accomplished is there because he just told you the permanence and the platform of your justification is your identification in Christ, which takes care of your sins that come from your sin. So he had to take care of the sin first. So he's done both. And that's how he moves into the issue in chapter 6, 7, 8 about your sanctification. Because not only did he pay for all of your sins, he took care of the root from which they come, which is your association with Adam. So Romans chapter 5, there are two men, Adam and Christ. If you're in Adam, condemnation, death, and slavery. Lake of fire is going to be yours. When you're in Christ, you've got righteousness, the righteousness of God, justification unto eternal life, and you're free from the reign of sin, and you're able to reign in life through that righteousness which is yours in Christ Jesus. And that's what chapter 6, 7, and 8 is going to explain how that works. Okay? So it's important. There's two men, but there's only one real solution, and that's the solution in Christ. Now, when I think about those things, I think, you know, people say, well, that's kind of esoterical, brother, and it is. But life comes out of the way you think. And if you don't have a thinking process that matches the reality, then you're in a dreamland. Father, we thank you tonight for your word and for an understanding of who you've made us in your Son by your grace and for your glory. In Christ's name, amen.